This is the Dery Brothers Tribecast, a podcast for diehard Cleveland Indians fans, presented to you by WaitingForNextYear.com. Now, here are the hosts, Matt and Todd Dery.
Labor Day is done, and now we're getting ready for the stretch run. Matt and Todd with you. It is Dery Brothers Tribecast from WaitingForNextYear.com, brought to you by our friends at the Center for Advanced Dentistry, and also Breaking Tea t-shirts at BreakingTea.com/DeryTribe. A winner last night. We record on a Tuesday. Indians starting up a four-game series the right way with a win over the Royals. They've won 9 of 12, Todd. They're tied for first with the White Sox. All is seemingly good right now with the way they played, although the bats still are up and down. Lindor's base running, Jose's thumb. We can get into a lot of stuff. We can talk some Ed Slott if you want today.
I'm going to start off by saying that I have never had like a major catastrophe at my home before. And yesterday, with that terrible, so we're talking Monday, that terrible rainstorm here in Cleveland that many of you went through and saw, it just pounded us. And my basement flooded yesterday. It was terrible. I spent my entire day, basically from 11:30 to about 7 p.m. on my feet, some pumping water out a window like that we cracked open that I didn't know even opened in my home. Carrying buckets full of water out up the stairs and dumping them out onto the driveway. Shop vacs, two shop vacs going. Not Kelly Shopik, but a couple shop vacs working. And I will say this, I have great neighbors who dropped everything and came over and assisted.
Really? That's awesome.
Including the unnamed neighbor on the corner with who could not have been nicer. And it actually makes me feel some type of way about maybe we can all live harmoniously in a perfect world, in the end we can all get along and all help each other, and it's actually was a very nice thing. But to all you out there who have gone through and had flood damage and all this stuff, and you see these stories, listen, mine was obviously not like my entire house was destroyed by any means, but it was a crazy, crazy day. And these people that, go through these catastrophes and lose everything, it's horrible. So today we're just waiting on the insurance claim to go through, and the ServPro will be here this afternoon checking everything out. And by the way, shout out to Lindell Insurance. Even though he's not my insurance guy, he's the insurance guy.
You are shot out of a cannon right now.
But yes, I am.
Well, were you able?
I still managed exactly.
Yeah, were you able at 6:10 to tune into the Zach Plesac Express?
I did. Luckily, the water damage did not affect the basement television, so I did have the TV on. I was in and out watching the game yesterday. Yes, I was. But I did watch most of the weekend series, so we can certainly talk about the 2 out of 3 game wins over the Brew Crew. And we can talk about double barrel action, and we can talk about pulling rabbits out of the hat, if you'd like.
I think it's time to set the record straight here. Number one, back in the summer of, I believe it was 1993, yours truly. Hey, Twitter world, it's me, yours truly. But no, I interned at Channel 5. It was the summer of my sophomore year in college. And I interned under Nev Chandler, the late Nev Chandler. I was Nev's last intern before he passed away. But Nev was very, very ill and rarely worked. Bob Stevens was running the show mostly at Channel 5 at the time in the sports department. And there was also Matt Underwood and Lisa Berkey. So we had a big...
What a crew.
big staff. So I worked with Matt Underwood. I know Matt Underwood. Not saying I'm friends with him, whatever. And the Indians broadcasts are highly watched. They are one of the top-rated broadcasts in terms of home rating. I think a lot of it is due to the fact that People don't go to the games and whatever. I mean, the Indians are...
They've had high ratings when people were going, you know, in general, when fans...
People seem to be watching, yes. And the argument always is that baseball's boring, and we could get into that another day. But yes, Matt Underwood, the 1980s references, the cliches, Johnny on the 80s. Spot...
70s.
70s and 80s. Rabbits out of the hat, double barrel action. I mean, it's just, it's nonstop. I mean, come on. Once in a while.
Can I say something? He's a lovely, lovely man. He is. And I don't know him personally. I hear nothing but nice things about him as a human being.
Yeah, I worked with him. He's a nice guy.
My boy, Jeremy Bilski, who went to fantasy camp a couple times, said he was super cool, down-to-earth guy, you know. So, this has nothing to do with him as a person.
No, we're not taking personal shots, but I'm not sure how much more of this I can take of the he's got to update. He's got to update his Rolodex here.
Yes.
Andre Knott is extremely hip. Andre's constantly tweeting about hip-hop songs and sayings and things from... What year are we in? 2020?
Present day.
You know, and Underwood's talking about 38 special. You know, a guy has 38 on the back and gets a base hit, and Underwood goes, that was a 38 special.
The other day he said something about it. Have you ever seen the TV show To Tell the Truth? And that was like from the 1972. I mean, listen, you and I'll make a Trading Places reference here and there. I get it. You know, we're all guilty, but we also aren't on TV every single day. So regardless, let's try
puts up a crooked number. 8 is enough. Back after this. Shut up. No one knows what 8 is enough is, except maybe like a few of us.
Me and you, Tim Van, wasn't it Dick Van Patten?
I guess.
Wasn't he the guy?
I don't know.
Or is it? I don't know.
I don't even remember.
No one knows who Dick Van Patten is on the show anyway. Oh, whatever. All right, go ahead. Sorry, let's talk about some baseball business.
So the Indians are 26-15. That's not bad. 11 games over 500, tied with the White Sox for first place. Chicago doesn't lose. They won like four straight.
7 out of 10.
Yeah, they've been rolling, and now they get to play the Pirates. I mean, the White Sox schedule lately has been soft, but hey, look, we play the Pirates. We play the Royals now.
Same schedule they play.
Right.
Same schedule.
So,
they could be looking at us and going, oh, great, they get four more against the Royals.
Right, but the Indians, the reason the Indians have been winning, again, goes back to the starting pitching. The bullpen's been pretty good still. You know, Whitgren's come in and done a nice job. Karinchak, who was the hotness for a while, is now ice cold. But other guys have even stepped up. Heck, Sunday, out of nowhere, Dominic Leone's firing bullets and getting Christian Yelich to swing and miss. Although, I don't know what's happened to that guy. He's a complete mess. But, you know, here we are for three more with the Royals, like you said, and then a huge weekend series with the Twins coming up. But Todd, first and foremost, again, I mean, the starting pitching's been great. And you watch Plesac last night and you wonder if the Indians will either know their seeding at the end of the year, if they want to line up their pitching a certain way, would Zach Plesac be number two behind Shane Bieber?
It's a very interesting question. First of all, we don't know because obviously in COVID they haven't like put any schedules out or whatever. But I don't know, and maybe I just don't know. I don't think that the schedule for when they're going to start games and where, because they still haven't figured out if they're going to do it in a bubble. So if there is going to be a gap where the Indians can line up their pitching, because listen, the Indians, the White Sox, and the Twins are all making the playoffs. And in a year where there's no home field advantage, the top seven teams in the American League are basically all the same, right? So Tampa, the Indians, the White Sox, the Twins, Houston, and Oakland, those seven are pretty much all, but those are six. They're all pretty much blended in, right? And then you got the Yankees, who you're not going to want to face them, but they're 21-20. I know they're injured.
Did you see last night? Ottavino imploded. They gave up 10 runs in an inning last night. 10.
They were up 5-0. Gave up 10. Yeah. So really, it's whoever gets that last. Really, the one seed is what's important because you're going to be. It's these other teams are all bunched up. So I don't think it really is going to matter where you are, but I do think it's going to matter how you line your pitching up. So I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see how Sandy slash Tito, if Tito's even here, manages that last week of the season when you're playing. The good news for the Indians is their last three games in the regular season are against Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
So you have four against at home. The White Sox. And three against Pittsburgh at home. That's how they finish. So obviously you want Bieber lined up for game one. But like you said, if the playoffs started today and the way the other guys are pitching, I think you might go Plesac in game two. His stuff's playing really well in these first two starts. He's basically been fastball changeup, but he's mixing in the slider. I don't know if it's the old, well, maybe we should have Carrasco in game two. He's the veteran. Or maybe you don't say anything, and these guys are all fresh, and you see, okay, you win with Bieber in game one, and then maybe you say, okay, we got two chances to win one game. Maybe you go with Carrasco here, and then, you know, if it's a do-or-die game three, you think Plesac's going to be better. You need one pitcher to start one game. You go Plesac. And then, you know, Savali hasn't been as good in his last two starts, but he's obviously got to be in that mix too, right?
Yeah, and you love his moxie. You love he's the same no matter what. If it's, you know, a rainy day and it's the elements are against him. If it's sunny, no matter which lineup he's facing, no matter which uniform he's wearing, red, gray, white, blue, whatever, he's the same guy. And that would be a guy that I think you're right. If you started Savali in game three, let's say, and it was a must have, he wouldn't get nervous. He wouldn't be like, oh my gosh, it's you know, you're assuming you're right that Bieber wins game one in a short series. And actually, for people that don't realize it either, this is not seeded by best record. So the Indians right now would be the four seed because they do have the best record of the wild card teams based on the White Sox. Let's say the White Sox. Well, this was before it was tied.
Right now, the way the standings are listed is the Indians are ahead of the White Sox now.
But I was looking at it last night, and they were a half game back, and the Indians were four, and the Blue Jays were five, based on Toronto is the second team out of the AL East and the second best second place team. The Twins have a better record than the Blue Jays, but the Twins were the seventh seed. If the Indians finish in third place, but have better records than all these other teams, they'll still finish seventh. That's how it works. It's stupid, okay. But that's how they're seeding it by the best three. Obviously, the top three seeds are the division winners, and then the next three seeds are the best records of the second place teams. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So the Indians could finish third in the division, have a better record than Toronto, have a better record than the Yankees, and or Houston, and still get slid down to the seventh seed.
Yeah, sure.
So it's interesting. I like the way Plesac's pitching, like you said. I mean, sometimes you look up and you go, man, our pitching's been so good, and then you do see who they're playing against. And that's why the really good test will be this weekend. You love the fact that Shane Bieber will pitch game one Friday night in Minnesota. You know, but the Twins are as good an offense as there is. Same with the White Sox. The division's really improved. I mean, I know the Royals are bad. But the Tigers, the unnamed team, excuse me, they've gotten better. They're not as bad as some of these other teams are in some of these other divisions. So, yeah, I wouldn't. Plesac's been good. But this is a good problem to have, Todd, that this rotation's humming right now.
The only other thing I was thinking about with Plesac is because he's been so good, and we've talked about this before, we talked about the beginning of the year, maybe they want his stuff to play out of the pen in the playoffs. I don't know, but here's a very good stat I saw from our friend Mandy Bell. So the Indians are 9-3 in their last 12 games, and in that span, the starters have pitched 70 innings with 70 strikeouts and only allowed 17 home runs, which is a 2.19 ERA.
Whew, the rest
of the baseball world would kill for those numbers.
It's still how you win, and we're going to talk about the offense and stuff. And look, I mean, even last night it was like, you know, sack flies, ground outs, fielder's choices. It's still very painful at times to watch this team.
Sure, but
You know,
if you score five runs with this pitching staff, you should win every game.
Right. I mean, even, you know, Saturday and Sunday, they got wins over the Brewers. The Friday game was a clunker, and you're going to have those. And I never liked the first game back home after a long road trip. That one always scares me. And then you throw Corbin Burns in there on Friday. He's a very good pitcher. And you know, Woodruff did his job Saturday, and then Brett Anderson usually hurts us. It took us a while to finally get to him Sunday, but just the lack of clutch hitting. I'm done complaining about Francisco Lindor's clutch hitting. It's just not there, and it's not going to be. I'm not going to sit here and I think we'll scratch our heads and we'll pull our nails out or whatever, bite our nails off in the playoffs when he comes up with second and third and pops out. But I'm not. My expectations have been lowered on him in the clutch. It's not good. It's not good. It's not, and it's not gotten to getting any better. Last night, his base running mistake. What was that? What was he doing?
It was very bizarre because when he came back, it's almost like he touched the base and then he retouched it again. But it's almost like he thought to himself, because you could see he didn't like run hard. He just like slowed down and jogged. He was almost like, yeah, no one saw that. I didn't go back and touch the base. I'm just going to continue. He's made a lot of mental mistakes this year, which have been a little confounding to me, but he is hitting the ball better. He just, it's still when there's runners, and I'm still waiting for that big runners in scoring position late in the game, you know, tie game, or they need an extra run or whatever. It comes, and he comes up and he puts one in the gap with two on. I mean, I'm still waiting on that, but
keep waiting.
And this is a good transition into the next topic. Now the bigger problem is Jose Ramirez has been dealing with this thumb problem, and yesterday he aggravated it, and they took him out of the game just as a precautionary thing, according to Sandy. And Mike Freeman came in and played third base. And okay, Mike Freeman is fine. This is not about Mike Freeman. But if right now you're in the middle, you got three more games against the Royals. You obviously want a healthy Jose Ramirez on the weekend. So you got these three games where you could rest Jose Ramirez and hopefully, you know, get his thumb feeling better. I think now is the absolute opportune time to bring up Nolan Jones and play him at third base for three games. And let us see what he can do. Let him swing the bat against the major league pitching. Why not? What do you have to lose here? It's not a service time thing. It's right now you're carrying three catchers on the roster, which is completely unnecessary.
Correct.
Two of which can't hit at all. And really you don't need that to happen. So it's not like they need the roster spot. Oh my God, you know what's going on? Whatever. Plucker never pitches either. So, I mean, right now it's almost like you have a 23-man roster. Not 23-man. They carry 28 now. So 26-man roster almost. So if I were the Indians, I'd bring up Nolan Jones today and say, you know what? You're going to start at third base for the next three games. Let's see if we can get an extra hot bat in there. Let's see what you can do. Listen, if it's a total disaster and he falls on his face, who cares? You can go back to Freeman if you want. You can send Nolan Jones back down. But maybe you catch lightning in a bottle. Why not?
I think it'd be exciting. I don't think they're going to do it. I think they're going to bring Yu Chang up.
Of course they're not going to do it. That's the problem.
It's funny because the guys at letsgotribe.com did that whole spiel this morning, and they're like, here are the 10 options that are there for Jose Ramirez's replacement if he's out a while. And all 10 were Nolan Jones. It was actually a really funny article. But, I mean, I just think they're ultra conservative. I don't think it has anything to do with money. The guy hasn't had an at-bat all year. Like, Yu Chang at least has gotten some ABs. He's played in big league competition this year. Nolan Jones is down at, the minor league camp, playing in simulated games. So I'm with you. I can't disagree with you. Especially against Kansas City these next couple of days. And I know one of the games is Danny Duffy on Wednesday. So it would be a lefty, but
giving
him an opportunity would not bother me in the least. Would not bother me in the least.
I mean, when we're talking about Yu Chang coming up, I mean, Yu Chang, it's fine. They'll probably bring him up, and if they do it, I don't think Yu Chang said more. How many at bats has Yu Chang had this year? I bet it's no more than, let's see,
a dozen? I'm 12?
You know how many bats he's had?
10?
9. Say no more than 15. He's at 9 bats.
Here's the other thing.
9 more plate appearances than Nolan
Jones. Here's the other thing you can find out about Nolan Jones is for next year, because they're cutting payroll And we love Cesar Hernandez. We'd love to give him a long-term deal and keep him around. He'd be fantastic. If these owners, and Terry Pluto wrote about it, if all these owners are crying poor so badly, including the Dolans, you know, and you're going to have all these new faces next year, Hand won't be back. Who knows if Santana will be back? He won't be back at that $17 million number. You know, Cesar's only signed for 1 year. I know it's only $6.5 million, but if they're cutting costs, next year Nolan Jones could be your third baseman anyway because he's on the cheap, and they'll just move Jose over to second. So that's an option.
I have a different plan for Nolan Jones, which is Cesar Hernandez comes back at another low number because there's going to be no free agent money out there. And then what they should be doing, and I don't know if they are, but what they should be doing is Nolan Jones should be shagging fly balls in the outfield.
Why not? You wonder if he is. You wonder if he already has been.
Yeah. You know. I'd rather if Cesar, first of all, Cesar Hernandez, I could argue that he's a top three player on this team start to finish this year.
He's there every day. Always delivering. He's been awesome.
He's been the most consistent offensive player they've had. He hasn't been in any prolonged slumps. And he gives you that great at bat. He sees a ton of pitches. And we were so used to Jason Kipnis. God bless Jason Kipnis. I'm glad he's doing well with the Cubs. But as a second baseman in the last few years, nobody's turned a double play slower. And his range was diminished. Cesar Hernandez turning that double play, his hands are so quick. I mean, it's beautiful to watch him out there. I bring him back, and Jose Ramirez has been playing third base now consistently, basically since the second half of 2016. He again is arguably your best player, 1 and 1A with Frankie. Are you really just going to move him out of third base where he's really turned? How about that play he made on Sunday?
Oh, sick!
Are we really just going to move him out of there and move him to second base so an average defender in Nolan Jones can play third base? I'd rather have an average Nolan Jones outfield where you have holes in the outfield. I mean, who knows about Josh Naylor? We don't know. So Nolan Jones should be taking some fly balls in the outfield down there in East Lake.
It'd be great. I have no issue with that. I mean, obviously left field's been a big problem. I know Josh Naylor is... I think they're going to give him every opportunity to play and play a lot, and they hope that his bat is a nice addition so far. He hasn't wowed me, but he's pretty much done what he did in San Diego, was occasionally a couple of hits. You know, it's going to take him a little while.
Yeah, he's been decent. I mean, he hasn't been terrible. I can tell you that.
It's been nice to see Oscar Mercado back. The hit he had against Josh Hader on Saturday night was enormous for his confidence, and... You know, I the play made last night against the wall made absolutely no sense. He just like ran into the wall. It was like playing Baseball Stars on Nintendo.
That was not great.
No. But you know, they're winning, and he's the future out there. It's not Delino DeShields, and I know they want to win now, and Tito likes veterans and everything else. But the fact that Mercado, that hit on Saturday night, even though it was just a leadoff double in a tie game. Man, that was so big for his confidence. Huge. Like, he needed that so badly. He was lost. Lost.
Yeah. Especially when it was the first hit that Josh Hader had given up this entire season, which is an incredible stat to begin with. I mean, the fact that Hader hadn't give up a hit, and that Devin Williams came in for the two innings beforehand. New member of Team D's Devin Williams, I see.
There you go.
By the way, NL only action.
That's right.
Yeah, he was as dominant. Boy, did he look good. And they brought in Hader. I was like, yeah, we're not getting any hits. And in five pitches, game was over between Mercado and Cesar Hernandez. So, yes, I like that he played, by the way, 3 days in a row. Like, he got that. They gave him an at-bat Friday night, and he got a hit. He came up Saturday, and they gave him a start. He had a double, which was good, walked twice, and then they kept riding him. They played him Sunday. They played him Monday. Just play him every day. The Shields can come in for defense late in games. I mean, we've talked about it many times. He's a good guy to have on your bench as a fourth outfielder, but that's what he is. Let Oscar ride it out at this point. Let's see where we go, and if he totally falls on his face, then he can go back to the Shields.
Yeah. Matt Dery, Todd Dery, it is the Dery Brothers Tribecast, your weekly look at the Cleveland Indians, brought to you by WaitingForNextYear.com. Please like our page on the Apple Podcasts, on iTunes, subscribe. We're brought to you by our friends at BreakingTea.com. If you go to BreakingTea, the letter T.com/Dery, anytime you go to the site now, go to BreakingTea.com, but use the slash Dery part. You can get some sweet-looking T-shirts. The Jose Ramirez home run pitch shirt is awesome. Bieber Fever, the new Karinchak shirt. I also have it on good authority, Todd, that a close personal friend of ours and friend of the podcast and texting Maven.
I don't out him, though. It's a secret until it drops.
But he and his family are working on a Franmil Reyes Franimal shirt, which could be out soon. So anything you want. You want some Browns gear? You want some cool Tribe shirts? You want the Bieber Fever shirt? I mean, shit, this guy is going to win the Cy Young. Might even win the MVP. So get your Bieber Fever shirt at BreakingTea.com/Dery. Click on the shirt. Then when it says want the promo code, put in TribeCast10, T-R-I-B-E-C-A-S-T 10, and you'll get 10% off that order. It's very simple. They got brand new stuff all over the place. You're a Cal Ripken guy like our buddy with the Cavaliers. You want the Iron Man 2131 shirt? They got new ones that they just put out. They're really sweet. Are you a Move the Sticks, Daniel Jeremiah, Bucky Brooks fan? Jeremiah Brooks 20 shirts. You know, like election T-shirts. They're out. The Slam Diego shirt's hot. Whatever it is, go to BreakingTea.com.
That Slam Diego tee is sweet.
It is sweet. Well, you can get it at BreakingTea.com/Dery. How about Bert Blylevin is retiring from the
Bert,
Twins?
Baby, come on.
So I love Bert with the circled T-shirt. It's awesome. Go to BreakingTea.com/Dery. Shop for whatever you want. And then put the promo code TribeCast10 in at closing, at ship, at checkout, and get 10% off. It's our friends at BreakingTea.com. Get that Karinchak shirt as well. All right. So, you know, Todd, we're mentioning Karinchak. It's funny. You get into a close game. The one thing Sandy Alomar's been doing well is he's got a feel for where he should go in these tight games. And it seems like every game's 3-1, 4-2, 2-1. You know, even Bieber the other day had a 5-and-fly. And now, if you look at it and say, okay, in a one-run game, let's say the starter went 6. Who's pitching the 7th? Who's pitching the 8th? Who's pitching the 9th? Right now, Brad Hand's been fantastic. Karinchak hasn't been. It looks mechanical, but he's gotten lit up the last 3 times. Are you concerned?
I think ever since I came on this podcast and said that he was as dominant as Andrew Miller in 2016, it's been all downhill from here. So it's my fault. I apologize to James Karinchak. No, in all seriousness, am I concerned about it? Here's why I'm concerned. This weekend, essentially since his last blowup, they have not even... Friday night, he was bad again. Sandy didn't go to him Saturday, Sunday, or Monday. It's like they're giving him a mini break. So yesterday was a prime opportunity to bring him in the 8th. He went to Whitgren again. The beauty of this bullpen is you have so... With Karinchak not pitching well, you have so many guys who've done a nice job. Like you brought it up earlier, listeners to this pod and followers of me on Twitter know I'm no Dominic Leone fan, but somehow he got through a 7th inning. He had that nasty strike 3 for the 3rd out. He looked pretty good. Cal Quantrill got a little shot with the lead the other night. I'd like to see more of him. You know, you still got, obviously, Oliver Perez, and Whitgren's done an awesome job. And I tweeted this out this weekend. I mean, all we have done in this town for the, you know, from basically the All-Star break up until about a month ago was talk about when will Brad Hand be replaced? This guy sucks. It's time for him to go, yada, yada. The last time we discussed him on this pod, I had said, you know what? I am not moving him out of the closer's role until he has a sustained 3 or 4 bad blown saves or outings in a row. Let's ride this while we can. In his last 13 appearances, 12 1/3, 0 earned runs, 15 Ks, 3 walks, 6 hits. You can't argue with those numbers right now. I mean, yes, the the more analytic numbers will tell you that it's still not great. The velocity's still not great. His slider's looking better. But if he's not putting any guys on base and in his last 13 appearances has not allowed an earned run and he hasn't blown a save, why would you ever mess with that? So I think he deserves a lot of credit for overcoming what looked like a total downslope of his career and the end of him being a closer.
No, I mean, you know, you looked at the start of the year and he was barely touching 90 with his fastball. And you're right, when the back foot slider, as Tom Hamilton would say, was just not doing its thing, you were like, what are we doing here? And Karinchak was dominant. I know Zach Meisel pointed it out. It's probably something mechanical with Karinchak right now. You know, they're hitting his fastball, the curveball he doesn't have the confidence in, which usually he was throwing for strike one, which was pretty gutsy to do. I mean, some of the at-bats earlier in the year he had against appearances he had against Nelson Cruz where he was just killing him with the curveball, same with Castellanos, two very good hitters. It was just, like you said, dominant. So they need him. They need him. I'm not as concerned as you are. I think they'll get him. You know, whenever you got Ruben Niebla, I'm always convinced that he'll find something and they'll work this out. I love that he stayed away from him the last couple nights. But again, in a tight game tonight, let's say, I hope he's back out there. He needs confidence. He needs to get three outs and do his crazy run off the mound routine into the dugout, talking to himself with his glove over his mouth. We need to see that because as we get into October, and like you said before, they're going to make the playoffs. He's going to be a big part of it. You know, we need the Karinchak brand. We need the brand back.
We do need the brand. We didn't see the brand all weekend. The executive producer saw the brand this weekend, but we didn't see the brand. I'll say this about Karinchak. First of all, you're going to see if tonight there's a save situation. I got to believe he's coming in the ninth. Hands pitched 3 days in a row. So he will not be available. It was interesting that Sandy went that way last night, too, with a 5-2 lead. I thought maybe that was the spot for Karinchak, and you give him the night off because he had pitched two nights in a row. But he didn't go that direction. So maybe he's setting it up where tonight will be, you know, they'll have another lead, and Karinchak will be the guy who pitches the ninth. I don't know.
I don't know if he's going to bring him in a save opportunity. I think if you're right.
Who's going to pitch the ninth then?
Probably Whitgren.
Phil? Uncle Phil, baby, my guy?
Phil pitches every night. I mean, he's just a rubber.
It's funny. I feel like he's pitched a ton, and Ollie has not pitched a ton. Lately.
Correct. Yeah. No, I think they're saving Oliver for the playoffs. I think they figure he's 39. You know, we're making this thing, and you know, they're and also think his role has changed. Now that you have to face three batters, he's not pitching as much. But you're right. Every day, Maton, he's out there every day, Ton.
This pen is just loaded, right? I mean, if you, at the beginning of this season, all we did was talk about, oh, my God, question marks in the bullpen. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? How are we going to figure it out? They've been awesome. Between Whitgren, Whitgren, Maton, Oliver Perez, you got Karinchak. Leon's been fine. I don't love Simber, but again, he's been good enough.
No, right? Sandy pulled him quick last night. He was not
waiting. Which was the right move. I liked it. He wants to win. He didn't have it. Why? Tito would have left him out there longer. The one thing about the three-batter minimum is it's forcing Simber to have to face left-hand bats, which is not exactly good for him. But, you know, listen, he was like, hey, I'm up four runs. Everyone's got it. These guys are all got a pitch. Let's see what we can do. Maybe Simber can get through it. Obviously couldn't, so Sandy wasted no time. He's trying to win games. I like it.
I wish Cam Hill was still there. I think he's got a lot of potential. I think he's better than Simber. I think he's better than Leon. But again, this is the problem we have. Being 11 games over 500 is complaining about who our last reliever is. I mean, I think that we talked about injuries with Jose. I mean, Roberto Perez's shoulder's a concern. I mean, his swing's a mess.
Yeah, and I think that's a big part of the reason why they're keeping three catchers right now. I mean, I think we all agree that we've seen enough of the Sandy Leon experience. I mean, I know I have. He's just eek.
Oh, wait, hold on a second. I think Sandy Leon just had another catcher's interference here at 11:11 in the morning. Jeez, I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah, well,
how many of those have we had this year? All right, let's preview the rest of the week. But first, you got to tell us what's going on. You sent a selfie recently to us, myself and Jeremy, in regards to a photo with you and the great Dr. Ben Hornstein. I mean, that made my day right there.
I was going to post it on Twitter, and I may do it today as a promotional tour for the podcast. Yeah, I had my appointment with Dr. Ben. Let me tell you something. Not only did Dr. Ben come in and give me, you know, the A-plus royal treatment, which I richly deserve with all these promotions that I do every week, but Sandy, who has been cleaning my teeth as a hygienist, Sandy was so delicate this time. I'm telling you, it's like I had my mouth open and she wasn't even there. It was so good. I went in for my monthly appointment. And as I said, you know, Dr. Ben and the Center for Advanced Dentistry, they're all about making you feel at ease and comfortable and safe. So when I got to the parking lot, I called. Sue answered the phone. She let me in. She said, come on in. I went in. I went right into my pod where Dr. Ben and Sandy greeted me. Dr. Ben took his extra special care of me. He puts this little blue light in, checking for mouth cancer, as he always does, because he's doing it all over there. Not only is he looking for stuff going on with your teeth, but he cares about everything. So in the meantime, Sandy did a great job of cleaning me. Doc came in. He closed it up like Brad Hand in the ninth inning. Fabulous experience. And I said, you know what? I got to take a photo with you because you're such a legend. Took a photo with Dr. Ben. Got out of there. Everything was good. I had an appointment at 11. And you know what time I was in there? At 11. It wasn't 11:30, sitting in the waiting room, sitting in your car waiting. They took me right at 11. Everything worked out unbelievably well, as it always does there for the Center for Advanced Dentistry, right off of Chagrin Boulevard on Orange Place. If you're on the east side and you need a dentist, heck, if you're on the west side, I said it before, I'll say it again, drive 30 minutes and come see the best dentist in Northeast Ohio, in America. Dr. Ben Hornstein, Center for Advanced Dentistry, CFAD.net, or check them out on Twitter at CFAD Beachwood.
Man, that photo just made my day. It was fantastic stuff. So tell Ben we said hey. I miss him. I get an occasional text from him, but he's obviously a lot closer with you, as you're closer to him distance wise. So it's just awesome, and love that they're a part of what we do here at the Dery Brothers Tribecast. All right, so. Got to get these games against the Royals. You know, KC's already without Salvador Perez. Jorge Soler, their cleanup guy, or number three hitter, depending on what the great Mike Matheny does with his lineup. He's been hurt with an oblique injury, so you got to take advantage. Tonight, Tristan McKenzie back at it. Always fun to watch a T-Easy toe the slab, as Matt Underwood would say, against Jacob Junis, who we saw last week. Carrasco and Duffy on Wednesday night. All these are 6-10 games. And then Thursday night, Aaron Civale against the rookie Brady Singer. So, again, you're seeing two righties and a lefty the next 3 days. Then the interesting part comes next week. Tough road trip ahead. You got three in Minnesota. Well, Friday, Saturday, Sunday this week. Yeah. Three in Minnesota. Yeah. The next week, two at Wrigley. One of those games, I believe, Yu Darvish is pitching. And then four in Detroit, including the Friday night affair, which I will be rooftop-wise at the Detroit Athletic Club, taking that baby in. But what will be interesting is this weekend. Now, Minnesota, Todd, I don't know if you saw this. The Twins are playing a double. They finished up their series with the unnamed team yesterday. And thanks a lot to the unnamed team for losing four or five games there. Thanks to your help. But now... Bieber on Friday night, but the Twins played today a doubleheader against the Cardinals and then have 2 days off. Did you see this? They're off Wednesday, Thursday. So they can
schedule 2 days off?
Yes. Yeah. I don't know why that
is. How is that even possible?
I don't know. It's a doubleheader against the Cardinals. I don't know if games got moved, but I'm telling you, I've looked at three different schedules to make sure I was right, and then I went to the Twins website and they talk about it. There's a doubleheader today against the Cardinals, and then they have Wednesday and Thursday off.
Yeah, it says Tuesday, and then their next game is listed as Friday.
Correct.
Bizarre.
It's a weird scheduling quirk. So they can line up, however they want. Now, Berríos and Dobnak are pitching today, so one of those two could pitch Sunday. My guess is Maeda would pitch because he's pitched well against the Indians for the most part. He would pitch Friday against Bieber. And then Pineda, as you like to call him, he's a cheating type, isn't he?
Puffy Pineda. Remember last year, he was so fat, and he pitched against the Indians, and he, like, totally destroyed us. I think he went, like, 7 scoreless. He struck out, like, 4. He was suspended for PEDs.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, that's fair.
That's right.
Yeah, it was ridiculous.
So I'm looking at Bieber and Maeda Friday. Saturday night on Fox National, Plesac against Pineda. And then, like I said, Sunday, McKenzie.
I think Rich Hill lines up before Pineda.
But wouldn't they skip him? He's garbage. Would they really pitch Rich Hill in any of these games?
I don't know. I mean, tribe against lefties, maybe they don't want to face the great Jordan Luplo.
That hit Luplo had on Saturday was hilarious. It hit the trademark. He didn't even know where the ball was.
Here, I'm looking at Rich Hill's last 3 starts.
Okay.
Unnamed team, he went 5 innings, gave up 6 hits, 2 earned runs, 5 strikeouts, no walks. In a loss. He's lost his last 4. Again, 3 and a third against the White Sox, 3 hits, 2 runs, 4 walks. And then the Tribe, 5 innings, 1 earned run, 5 strikeouts, 2 walks. So I don't think they'll skip him.
Right.
I don't.
Well, then my guess is he would pitch.
That's how it lines up. With Hill would be next, then Pineda.
Right, right. It would be Maeda, Hill, and Pineda if they lined it up that way. Berríos,
yes.
Or Dobnak. I mean, both of them are pitching today. And again, this doubleheader could totally throw everything out of whack for them.
Right.
Who knows? But regardless, Maeda bothers me. He's been a lot better than I thought he'd be. And he throws so much off speed and so much junk, and obviously we don't hit those guys very well.
No, we sure don't.
The changeup, whoever has a good changeup just destroys us. And I'll tell you one thing, they did a nice job in their approach against Brad Keller last night, but that kid's going to be really good. Keller and Singer in Kansas City in the future are going to be very good, very good.
Yeah.
But I don't know what the Royals are doing. How is Whit Merrifield not moved at the deadline? Like, are you rebuilding
especially
or not?
With that contract.
What are you doing?
With his contract, making no money.
Right.
And by the time you sell him off and you sell that as a piece going, hey, look at this contract. Look at the value you're getting. I mean, that should be – the contract alone is valuable with his versatility. And then you throw in the fact that he's a great hitter. I mean, they play him all over the diamond. He plays second. He plays center field. He plays third. Oh, he would have been ideal for this team, huh?
Oh my God. I would have loved him. So that's how it looks for this week. And, big series this weekend. You know, Minnesota, their offense is really good. Obviously, I'll be interested in seeing what they do and how long Jose's out and if they make a move. They might not even make a move. They might say, all right, take 2 days, relax. If we need you to, come in for defense, he can play defense. The issue just is him swinging the bat with that left thumb right now.
I think you just sit him for the next 3 days. Again, I'd love to see Nolan Jones, but my guess is you're going to see Mike Freeman, third base, for 3 straight days. And, it's funny, anytime anybody ever, and it was me, and I'm guilty of it a lot of times, too, if I ever tweet anything about Mike Freeman, Andre always tweets me back. He's like, lay off my guy, Free. He loves him. I have no problem with Mike Freeman once in a while. To me, there's no upside in playing him for 3 days when you could bring up Nolan Jones and see if there is some upside, and maybe you catch something good.
Yeah.
If he doesn't hit, Freeman could go 0-for-4, Why not let the kid try to go, do better?
We've spent the entire podcast, I haven't even really touched on Franmil Reyes and how good he's been.
How great he is.
Yep. He's been awesome. So, all right, that'll do it for the Tuesday edition. We had to move, we decided you wouldn't have been able to record yesterday anyway.
No chance. If I would have tried to record that pod yesterday, I may have slept in the basement
or the Holiday Inn or in Beechwood. I mean, that would not have been good. But you're a great dad. You're a great husband. keep up the great work. Are the fans still blowing down there? You got to go at least 24 hours.
The fans have been blowing since the second we got the water stopped. Yeah, I'm not touching those. First of all, I went down there this morning. It's still really, really wet. They're coming between 4 and 6 at some point today. to with the big guns. So I just have like fans that we borrowed. I think I have one of those big ones and a bunch of other ones that are the best we could get from neighbors. So four on my street alone, we have four people whose basements flooded completely.
Wow, that's crazy.
Just my street alone.
Oh man. All right, well, that'll do it for the Dery Brothers Tribecast. Let's get some more wins this week with the Royals, and we'll talk to you guys next week. See ya.